broke my 8-win streak. First loss in 2 months. It is what it is, you know. You almost sometimes need a loss just to remind yourself, like, anyone can be touched, you know what I mean? Like, I'm not undefeated. I've been tagged up many times. Every time I come back stronger, recalibrate, and I get more and more consistent. So straight into the loss review. Solza, you know, she got out-wrestled by Marcos, out-grappled, and just lost the decision. Hindsight 2020, when I look at this fight, I go, why the hell did I stack that many chips on a girl as one-dimensional as Solza? You know what I mean? Like, she's just not well-rounded. Obviously, Marcos being on a huge loss streak, or 4 loss streaks, so already I'm biased against her. Even before we saw the fight, could have said, look, Marcos will probably out-wrestle her, but Solza has a chance to submit her, and if she can't submit her, then it's a problem. And that's exactly what happened. Solza almost got her out of there in that first round, and then she literally just did not have anything else. Like, Marcos just out-grabbed her, took her down, and if she can't choke you out or armbar you, she's just gonna get controlled. Solza is very low level. You gotta take into consideration, like, Marcos coming off a 4-loss streak, her last loss being a DQ in a fight that she could have potentially won. Of course there's gonna be a fire lit under her going, like, I'm not gonna fucking lose my job over something like that, you know what I mean? I'm gonna come out of here hard. And that's what she did. So much respect to Marcos for winning that fight. I was an absolute idiot for having that much faith in a very one-dimensional fighter in Solza. And in regards to the wins, Alex Caceres, quick submission. Obviously, you know, he got hurt, had a timeout, came back quick and destroyed him. Before you guys get on to me and say, why didn't you tell us you're betting on him? That was a bonus bet. That was literally bonus credit points that Bet365 gave me for being a consistent member. So that's free money. That wasn't my actual money. I put that $200 bonus bet on him because I thought the odds were just too wide for a veteran. And he proved me right. Caceres is well-rounded as fuck. That's what happens when you get onto the hype train a little too early. And I knew that Choi just wasn't ready for this level yet. He might eventually be a title contender, just not yet. Jessica Rose Clark just out-wrestled her, controlled her. I really thought it would be more stand-up, Muay Thai plum, clinch range, body shots, elbows, knees. That's what I expected to be the narrative of the fight, but nah, it was the grappling. The level changes and the change in direction of her takedowns were amazing. I was very impressed with her, very impressed. And I know a lot of people were hating and saying, you know, why didn't she do more ground and pound? She wanted a win. Like, she just wanted to eke out a win. And when you have your paycheck on the line, I get it. But I also understand with the fans' perspective, like, look, if you want people to get behind you, be more entertaining. If she postures up and she starts raining down punches, that gives Edwards a chance to, you know, hip escape and get up. Edwards is clearly the better striker from a distance, the kickboxer. Like, she was dangerous. And Jessica was like, I'm just not going to entertain that, man. Touche to Jessica. Solid win for me, but I wish I put more money on that. Again, I did attempt to put 10 grand, but they fucking rejected it. So look, I lost. Read on this card, betting wise, was terrible. So I need to recalibrate, reset, go back to the drawing board, really pinpoint my next steps here. So moving on to the card, kicking off, we got Mega Man Ankalaev versus Volkan Ozdemir. Good matchup, man. Both guys knockout artists. Ankalaev more of a kickboxer, tall, long rangy, very agile, flexible hips. You know, he gets his leg up there super fast. Southpaw striker, so very awkward in that respect. Nice tight boxing, good defense, excellent body kicks, explosive. The dude's just dangerous, man. Fucking no one wants to fight him. This is just a tendency with Russian Dagestani fighters who are coming up, who are so dangerous. It's like, why would I fight this guy, man? He's so good and no one knows him. So I'm not really gaining anything out of this exchange. Ozdemir coming off a loss, obviously, he doesn't really have much of a bargaining chip. It's kind of like, we give you the fight and you take it. And knowing Ozdemir, he's just a fucking animal. Like, he's going to take any fight. He's a warrior. His rise up was absolutely phenomenal. Came up with the boop, destroyed Jimmy Manoa, knocked out Serkanov. He looked absolutely amazing. Fought DC, hurt DC in a couple exchanges before DC just out-wrestled him. Ever since he lost that title fight, he just hasn't been the same. I want to say he's regressed, but he hasn't improved. His stand-up's just the same thing. Move forward, high output. I'm just gonna get in your face and outwoo you with my stronger, denser frame. I punch harder than you, and I'm gonna get in your distance and make you uncomfortable. And he did that to Jiří Procházka. Now people forget, obviously Procházka is on the upward and doing well, but that fight was fucking dangerous, and Volkan almost finished him in that first round. He still has that power. You can't forget that, man. He might not be the most skilled, but if you make one slip up, you zig when you should have zagged, you're gonna get knocked out. That could easily be the outcome here against Ankalaev. I'm gonna favor Ankalaev though. I think he's more diverse. I think he has more paths to victory, and frankly, I think he's the better grappler. People don't talk about his wrestling, but he's got fucking good double legs. If he wants to, he can level change and just dominate you in a wrestling bout. You saw what he did to Nikita. You know, Nikita, he realized early and often that Ankalaev was the better striker. He's like, fuck, like, this is what I do, but you're better than me at my bread and butter, so let me level change, let me mix it up. And Ankalaev's like, you know what, fuck it, let's wrestle. Double-legged him, controlled him. Ankalaev's well-rounded, man. He's dangerous. His kryptonite obviously has been Paul Craig, a guy who could submit him at the end of the round in a fight that he was dominating. Ankalaev's submission defense isn't great. On top, it's improved, but Paul Craig's shown that you can get him. Ozdemir's not that guy. Offensively and defensively, he just doesn't have much on the ground. He really tries to stall, and he's more of a heavy-handed boxer that wants to stay on the feet and boop you. You know, he doesn't mind losing the first 2 rounds. He just wants to get you out of there. Knockout is his only path to victory here, and I don't see him getting it. Ankalaev's just too diverse, too well-rounded, and if he gets hurt, he's just going to double leg him, control him, and the discrepancy in grappling is too much. But again, I do see Ankalaev winning the striking exchanges and landing a head kick. Third round knockout by Ankalaev. Moving on, we've got Li Jingliang versus the return of Khamzat Chimaev, man. Chimaev burst onto the scene. You know, he came on and fought three guys within the span of, I think it was a month or two. So he was a huge fan favorite from the get-go. You know, just his style. They call him Evil Khabib. Khabib's always had short arms. And now imagine a bigger Khabib, long wingspan, and the wrestling prowess. His Dagestani arm trap is ridiculous. You know, the way he just holds a guy's arm from behind and just pounds them out. You can't get up because you only have one arm. You can't defend yourself properly. You might just shell up and put that high guard while he takes you back, and then he just uppercuts you from behind. Every single step on the ground, he's 2 and 3 steps ahead. And he has the long arms, and he has the ground and pound, and he has the submissions, and he has the stand-up. Like, he's shown again and again that he's improving leaps and bounds. People might say, look, he hasn't fought anyone, and you're 100% right. But that's no fault of his own. He wants to fight everyone. Guys have been ducking him left and right. It's kind of like the Ankalaev situation. I'm so fucking good, and I'm rising up, and no one wants to fight me. I just gotta fight anyone who's gonna say yes. And in steps Li Jingliang, the second most successful Chinese fighter behind Wei Lizhang, a high-level boxer, good heavy hands, strong low kicks, extremely powerful, good timing, dense as fuck. Like, he's one of those guys who's not overly big for the division, but for some reason, he just sleeps guys so easily. He just turns that off button. He's not TKOing you. He's knocking you flat out. He's gonna present certain problems if Chimaev gets cocky. If Chimaev's like, look, I want to keep it on the feet and I want to test my boxing, he can easily get knocked out here. Li Jingliang's the better boxer. Chimaev, he's improved 100%. You know, that knockout against Mishai was great. But we haven't seen a long extended period of his stand-up to where it's like, okay, he's got good head movement, good fence. You know, he's got good footwork, excellent positioning. We haven't seen that. Against Li Jingliang, I would be worried. I'd be careful because Li Jingliang has that power. Now, the difference is this isn't a boxing match. This is an MMA fight. And Khamzat's level changes and his wrestling threat. Jingliang, he's going to be like, fuck, I got to be careful. I can't overextend and I just unload with my combinations too early and often, because if I do, Khamzat's just going to level change and take me down. And that sheer wrestling threat, more often than not, reduce your output. You might see Li Jingliang coming out here and just looking extremely gun shy because he's afraid of the double leg, and that's what I'm expecting. Despite the fact that he's a veteran, he's never faced a wrestler like Khamzat, and if Neil Magny can manhandle him, Khamzat can definitely do that. I see Li Jingliang coming out here fainting, Khamzat entertaining the stand up a little bit, maybe throwing some kicks here and there, and if Khamzat will open up more than Li Jing, he would welcome Li Jing fucking going for a double leg, stuff him, reverse him, and take his back. Li Jing's gonna be like, fuck, when he's gonna shoot, when he's gonna shoot, and that mentality is gonna reduce his output. Khamzat's gonna start opening up on the feet, and then boom, double leg, take him down, Dagestani arm trap, pound him out. I think he's gonna out grapple him, maybe hunt for some submissions here and there, but then really just open up the defenses on the ground for Chimaev to start landing that ground and pound. Khamzat Chimaev by TKO in the second round. Moving on, we've got Alexander Volkov versus Marcin Tybura. Volkov coming off a pretty convincing loss against Gane. You know, Gane absolutely destroyed him on the feet, used his lead foot dominance, beat him on angles, had him circling. Volkov just couldn't do anything about it. I don't take much away from Volkov from that, because Gane is a special talent. Before that, against Overeem, just vintage Volkov. He's a smart heavyweight. You don't see him chasing for finishes. He really just touches you up with a jab, realizes your defensive mechanisms, and he noticed that Overeem just shelled up with his hands up high, and he went around the corner with a left hook and then uppercut, just finished him off in spectacular fashion. Against Tybura, he's very durable and he's got good grappling. He's going to try to tick you down, get into the mount and pound you out. Against Volkov, he's 100% going to try to implement that, because Volkov's too tall, too long, and too educated on the feet. Tybura's not going to try to entertain a stand-up, and if he is, he's going to be more defensive than offensive. Nothing from Tybura's game indicates to me that he can beat Volkov in a stand-up affair, and I definitely believe Volkov's going to dominate that aspect of the game for as long as it lasts. I think Tybura's going to desperately go for takedowns once he gets tagged up on the feet, and Volkov being too tall, too educated, his takedown defense is very good, and the only person really who could take him down repeatedly was Curtis Blades, the best wrestler in the division. Tybura doesn't stack up to that level of collegiate wrestling, and I don't see him being able to take down Volkov, a tall, tree-like figure who has a high center of gravity. That is hard to take down in the methods that Tybura normally does. You know, he's a body lock, drag you down. He's not a double leg guy. He's not a single leg guy, and that's the type of wrestling that you need to take Volkov down. Volkov's too strong, and he is just going to tag him up on the feet, defend the takedowns, wear him out, and hurt him to the point where he just can't last any longer. Volkov by third round TKO and an absolute massacre. Moving on, we've got Islam Makhachev versus Dan Hooker. Islam is a guy who's trying to take the throne that Khabib left. Khabib has passed the torch down. He's like, look, he's the next champ. And he's very different to Khabib in the respect that he's not a ground and pound guy. He's going for submissions. He's going for positional dominance. He's trying to take you back and submit you. Also on the feet, he's not trying to crowd you and fucking drown you like Khabib does. He's not just going to move forward and take punishment. He doesn't take much damage. Islam is very defensively responsible. He's a much better striker. His boxing is nice. His straight left's nice. His pullback counter is good. His kicks are nice. guys. And the fact that he has such a high level grappling skill set, he reduces guys' output just with that threat. You know what I mean? Like, just knowing that, hey, I can take you down and just fucking maul you. You better not get too overzealous. Now, Dan is an absolutely phenomenal kickboxer. Long rangey, tall, more bone than brawn, good boxing, good long range teeps, excellent kicks. Good feint. He's very much a smaller version of Adesanya in the respect that he has nice low kick feints. Kill your low body, really. Dan's gonna try to keep it long. I think the uppercut and the knee is what he needs to do against Makhachev. Just punish him every single time he goes for a double leg. If he can do what Aldo did to Mendez, where, you know, he breaks free and then knees him to a fucking knockout, that would be fantastic. Makhachev is just so much more defensively responsible than a guy like Chad Mendez, and we're talking about 10 years difference in MMA knowledge. I see him outboxing Dan and outstriking him. The wrestling threat, it's going to be too much for Dan to handle. You saw what happened against Chandler. Chandler just conditioned him to the straight right to the body and then landed that left hook to the head and got him out of there. Now, Dan was on his bike, on his back foot, because he didn't want to get taken down, man. That's what's going to happen here tenfold. His arms are much better wrestler than Chandler. Level change feints and his striking is a lot better as well. He's just a better overall fighter and he's bigger. He's going to really be an absolute problem for Dan, and you have to respect Dan for taking this fight. Before I, you know, obviously pick Islam, I got to take my hat off to Dan. Absolutely destroying Naskarat and then staying in Vegas and going, you know what? I'll take the fight. I won't see my family and I'll take this fight that everyone thinks I'm going to lose. So Dan's going to go for the knockout here, whether it's a high knee or a fucking uppercut. He needs to do something. And he has the potential to land that knee, man. Poirier said this as well. He didn't expect him to get his knee up that high that quickly. And I think Dan can do that in the clinch or in the grappling exchanges and time Makhachev. He can get a knockout here. I think that's too unlikely though. I think Makhachev, his feints and the way he sets up his opponents, he's not going to rush it. See Dan's tendencies and how Dan's going to try to set him up. Bait out the teep kicks, catch the kick, take him down. Control and wear him out. I don't see him finishing Dan. I think his grappling's improved a lot. I don't see Makhachev submitting or TKOing him. I just see him winning a dominant 3-0 unanimous decision. Moving on to the co-main event, we have Petr Yan versus Cory Sandhagen. Two high-level bantamweights, high-level strikers who are going to try to prove something to the world and to themselves. You know, Petr Yan absolutely upset. Coming off a DQ loss against Aljamain, where he dominated that fight from pillar to post. Aljamain had nothing for him, couldn't out-wrestle him. His stand-up is so imposing. He's got a very unique style in that he doesn't have much head movement. High guard, moves forward, very minimal movement, mechanically efficient. He moves just enough. He reminds me of Gennady Golovkin in that he moves just enough to do what he wants to do. He doesn't waste energy. Fucking very intimidating, man, the way he moves forward. Blocks and parries, everything you do, he minimizes and mitigates the damage before unloading on you. He'll give away rounds, you know, the first and second round. He'll let you unload and really download your information, download your offensive skill set, and be like, all right, that's what you're gonna do. You're gonna throw this combination, you're gonna do that to the body. All right, I understand you now. I haven't taken much damage. I've blocked everything you've thrown. I've thwarted all of your attacks and your attempts, but I understand you and you don't understand me. And that's what Petr does. And I see him trying to do that against Cory in this fight. Now, Sandhagen, a very mobile, offensive game, you know, good lateral movement, a lot of feints, very fancy, good flying knees, excellent boxing, switches stances every so often, nice long jab, tall, big for the division, 5'11". Corey's going to try to really just outbox and outkickbox Yan here, you know, just be on his bike, be defensive, and just mat it on the ball. That's what Corey's game plan is 100%. I don't see him trying to grapple Yan. His Petr Yan's grappling is much better than Sandhagen. Having a lower center of gravity and showing that he's a better grappler than Sterling is enough for me to know that he's going to out-grapple Sandhagen if it goes to that. Always make sure that if they do tangle up, he'll be the one to land on top. I don't think Corey's going to do that. I think he's going to entertain the stand-up, and he's going to realize that everything he throws is being mitigated by Yan. You know, he's throwing all these combinations, and Yan's just parrying, pushing off, and every time he does land, Yan's going to close the distance, put him in the clinch. I think Piotr's just too good defensively to lose this fight. Five rounds favors him. I think the first two rounds is going to be him downloading information, and then the last three rounds running to the finish and just absolutely tooling Sandhagen, being the more efficient guy. You know, I'm not going to move my head as much as you. I'm not going to be on my bike. I'm going to walk you down, cut off the cage, throw what you have at me. I'll mitigate it, block it off, and then I'm going to unload to the body, unload to the head. It's hard to read him. You don't know what he's going to do. And Sandigan's going to be very confused in the later rounds, I believe. I think Yan's going to walk him down the later rounds, maybe hurt him here and there. I don't think he'll drop him, but I think he's going to hurt him a few times and just drown him in the later rounds to a dominant, unanimous decision in a 4-1 round affair. Moving on to the main event, we got Jan Blachowicz versus Glover Teixeira. Wow, 2021, you just didn't think you would see these two guys fighting for the title. Absolutely crazy times we're in, man. Jan has shown that he is a significantly smarter fighter than we all expected. The last three or four fights, he was a betting underdog, and he's got a very basic style, good hands, decent low kicks, nothing fancy, but he's very durable, dense, strong, and he's got good timing. And more so than anything, very good adaptability and probing. One thing that I think Yan is better than most people in the division, he can download your skill set without showing his cards. Kind of like Petr Yan, slower, plodding, more power, but he's got that similar IQ, you know, I'm going to download what you have, I'll let you unload, and then I'm going to get you out of there. The fact that he outfought Israel and outsmarted him, that was the least likely outcome. We never thought that he would win a decision against Israel. He really just timed him with that body lock takedown and just destroyed him. Yan was like, bro, I'm better than you think. I'm gonna time you and I'm gonna understand your skill set before I break you down. This is a very interesting matchup because Glover, his rise to the top was literally 10 years ago, man. This guy's been around for a long time. He had troubles going to the US. Eventually, when he came in, he absolutely dominated the light heavyweight scene before getting destroyed by John Jones. And then he had a hard time since then. You know, he lost the Rumble, he lost his Gustafsson, and we just never thought that he'd come back. He's like, bro, you're on the worst side of your 30s. You just never thought he would come back. And he kept chipping away. He took every fight that he could, beating young guys like Ian Kutalaba, Jared Cannonier, Anthony Smith, Thiago Santos, like upsetting guys over and over and over. And just showing like, look, if you don't capitalize on the times that you hurt me, I'm gonna turn this around, I'm gonna outgrapple you, and I'm gonna submit you. Or I'll TKO you, ground and pound. But either way, Glover's grappling has shown to be top tier. And some of the best in the division. I think if there was no striking allowed, he would beat Blachowicz just with the grappling and probably submit him as well. But again, this is mixed martial arts, and I believe Yan defend enough takedowns and land enough on the feet to wobble and hurt Glover. I think he's got more in the tank. He's a much healthier fighter with a strong, durable chin, whereas Glover's been wobbled time and time again. He's taken a lot of damage, even in his wins. You know, he got tagged up against Smith before winning, tagged up and dropped multiple times against Santos before winning. Now, Yan, he's a fucking deal closer, man. If he hurts you, he doesn't let you off the hook. Against Reyes, against Corey Anderson, against Luke Rockhold, he hurts you, he's gonna get you out of there. I don't see Glover avoiding that type of punishment. Yan's timing, his durability, his power, his size, he's gonna eventually hurt Glover and he's gonna seal the deal. I just don't see Yan making that mistake that all these other guys are making. He's not gonna just run into him and get taken down by Glover. He'll hurt him, he'll walk forward, sprawl, take his back, pound him out. I think Yan wins by TKO, man. He's just too smart, too patient. He's got enough experience now to know that he doesn't have to rush these finishes, and Yan ground and pounds him to a victory. Moving on to the betting tips. I like Ricardo Ramos. I think he's been heavily underestimated. I think that he's a young version of Charles Oliveira. Tall, long-rangey, good kickboxing, good submissions, very lethal, and just dangerous all around the board. Now, I get that Zubera Tukhugov, you know, because he comes from the Khabib camp, he's just overestimated. That's just how it is. If you come from his brotherhood, you're just naturally going to have more favoritism on the betting lines because it's like, oh, he's Dagestani, he's dangerous. Zubera is one of the worst in their camp, in my opinion. He has a lot of glaring holes, conditioning-wise, stand-up-wise. His grappling's good, but he makes a lot of mistakes just rushing in. I kind of like Ricardo. He's got a lot cleaner striking. Better submission game. He's got a lot of avenues to win here by KO or submission. And him being an underdog is not bad. I would sprinkle a little low bet, and I might put some bonus credits on him. Bet365 gave me another $200. So obviously not risking anything. It's not my money. Amanda Ribas, I like her. I think she's better than Jana Roba in all facets of the game. Better stand-up. Jiu-jitsu might be neck and neck, but I think she's more dominant on top and her grappling is better. And I don't see Jana Roba out-wrestling her. If anything, Amanda might hip-toss her and be on top. Just ground and pound and control her. Jana Roba is dangerous with her back, but Amanda's jiu-jitsu is very high level, and she's not going to lose by submission. Her stand-up is significantly better than Jana Roba. Jana Roba is very basic and rudimentary on the feet, and Amanda's a lot sharper on the feet, very good defensively, and should just tag her up to a decision, man. I like Yan and Corey going the distance. I think they're both too high level on the feet. There's going to be a lot of feints, a lot of footwork play and distancing and tactical warfare here, and I think Yan will take over, but Corey's too tough. It's nice to bet going the distance with so much movement and so much output by both men. You can't really tell what the judges are thinking. You know, that fight against TJ was 50-50. I thought TJ won, but I can see both ways. You know, when it becomes so complicated to the point where the level of striking is above and beyond the understanding of the judges, they might just give it to Corey. So going the distance is safer, and I think that is the go. That's a bit of it, guys. I appreciate it. I'm excited for this pay-per-view. I'm very keen to get back on the winning ways, man. I wasn't happy with myself in this last performance, you know, betting on Salza. Fucking idiot, bro. Now, I know a lot of people in the comment section have been saying, hey, can you go through your losses even in your net profited wins? I might start this thing where I do a monthly betting review. And say, for example, December 1st, I release a video and go November in review, and have a look at all my bets in November, all the wins, all the losses, and just really make a comprehensive video to show my mindset and how I learn moving forward, because I have gotten significantly better. I've got a 75% win rate on a decent sample size. We'll see what happens. You know what I mean? If lockdown is still around, I'll have the time. I appreciate you guys. Follow my Twitter. Enjoy your families. I'll see you guys next time.